I feel like I'm immediately like a fuck this person. And I feel like an important thing for me is to, even if I'm faking it, try and play a better role socially, because I don't want to influence anyone else to feel bad, you know?
Hello, friends. Welcome to Mostly Harmless. I'm your host, Damien. Buddies, this week we are rounding out the end of the year with one of my favorite new discoveries, one of my favorite new bands. Today we're sitting down, we're chatting with Luke from Teenage Halloween. Teenage Halloween just put out their debut record on Don Giovani right here in the smack dab middle of this world pandemic. They were slated to take over the world, but they had to put the plans on hold. So we sit down and we chat with Luke about plans were for this year, what they're going to do next year, and then what's in the water in Jersey that makes band so great. We talk about honesty. We talk about a whole lot of cool stuff. Buddies, if you like what we got going on in today's episode, please subscribe on YouTube. If you like what we're doing, throw us a couple dollars on Patreon. We got a link down in the description below. No more rambling from me, you guys. Let's get to this chat with Luke from Teenage Halloween.
Oh, hey, what's Hi. Up?
Hey, buddy, how are you?
Good, how are you doing? Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, man, thanks for coming on.
I can already tell we're gonna be friends because of your shirt.
Oh, nice.
Like, yeah, no, I fucking love Kurt Russell.
Dude, me too.
That's awesome. Yeah, hell yeah.
Did you watch the Christmas Chronicles yet? Because I have not.
So I've heard my mom has loved it. Like she's like die hard about it. Actually, like she's been watching the Christmas Chronicles, and when I heard Kurt Russell was in it, I was like, oh, that sold me. Cause I'm usually like about Christmas movies. Like yeah. I honestly only like a couple, like A Christmas Carol, like those old ones, and like Charles and Die Hard, which is inherently a Christmas movie.
Yeah.
No, like that stuff's all fun. But yeah, when she said that Kurt Russell was in that, I was like, that is crazy. It's crazy, like when like the roles that Kurt Russell gets over time. Like it's I'm really trying to see Death Proof because I just heard about that. I never saw it.
So yeah, let's get started. All right, Luke. So we're recording this on December 28th. It's Monday, right after the holidays. How were your holidays?
It was actually nice. I preferred the option that we had this year of just being with your immediate family. I like my greater family, but like I feel like it was very refreshing in a way to be just like me, my sibling, and my mom just hanging out and watching movies. It felt a lot more calm, and I felt like a holiday is supposed to be like a vacation and a break anyway. So I was just like totally content with how it went.
Where are you living these days?
I live in Asbury Park. I'm with my family right now. I've been there for like 3 years since I moved out of Philly. I'm probably going back to like NYC at some point or Philly again in the next couple years. But yeah, no, at the moment I'm with my mom and sibling.
You've been there for 3 years. So you were already there when the lockdown and shutdowns and all that happened?
Yeah. Yeah. I've been there. Yeah. I've been here for 3 years. So when the lockdown started, I was already home. It was really strange. Cause I was planning to go on like a cross country thing. Then like this hit. And then immediately that came to a halt, and it was going to be in May. So like a couple weeks after lockdown started, like I was listening to people that were like, it's going to be a month. And then I didn't believe it, but like, I had like this back of my head hope being like, oh, that would be great. And then, yeah, this year has been just this chilling on the webcam with people. Yeah.
I've watched and listened to a handful of these interviews. You've done a lot of them this year. Obviously you probably weren't expecting to be, you know, you put out this amazing record this year giant fan of.
I didn't expect our big moment to be when everyone's chilling at home. Like that's like the main, like, all right, like people are finally knowing what we are and what we're about, but like, I can't see anyone. Like, it's crazy. Yeah. Like it's definitely the weird, I feel like it's like the weirdest story for us. Cause like we like put out our debut during this, so it's been like we haven't gotten to experience that full like album cycle like butter that comes with like playing on it and stuff.
I had pre-ordered this vinyl record.
Oh, cool.
forgot all about it. I was like, oh, this is great. This, what a cool record. Yes. Sold. Done. Talked me into
it. Yeah. Thank you.
Forgot all about it. It showed up a couple months later. I was very surprised. I was like, what is this?
Yeah. It is one of those weird things. So like, yeah, a couple of months. Yeah. This record has been on hold with like the pressing plant and stuff. And we put it out like probably 3-4 months ago. Yeah. And it just started coming to people. Like, what did you get yours? Like 2 weeks ago or so, something like that.
Something like that. Yeah. Maybe, cool. Maybe three. I can't remember.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's crazy. Yeah. It was halted for a second.
I was telling you already, like it's one of those that, this year, I haven't listened to a lot of new music. This year, I got really into jazz, a lot of orchestral stuff. I've been listening to a lot of Yo-Yo Ma, and people think I'm kidding. Cool. But absolute, no, that's so honest cool. truth. Yeah. And then this thing hasn't left my like turntable. It's barely left my turntable all since I got it. Nice. The other day, I was eating some gummy bears. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how many times. I just kept going, flipping it over. And flipping it over, and I was like, how many times cool. have I listened to this now? So it's an awesome record. I love it.
Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate it.
What is it, you know, typically for a typical band, you'd be out there on the road playing shows, meeting people day in, day out. How frustrating is it for you to be sitting at home right now instead of out playing shows, meeting people, touring the world, celebrating?
I was mad as fuck in the beginning, but I feel like now, because that I've gotten, because I get easily overwhelmed in social situations. So I feel like the fact that it has run its course already, and now I know what to expect when I come back out, it's not that bad. Like I kind of was, it was like, it's an anxious person's dream to be able to know what's going to happen when you get out of quarantine. And that's what I was given. Yeah. And it feels good. I was really upset for a couple months though. Honestly, and we all were like, we're writing a new record right now, and we haven't even gotten to play the first one. Like it's, yeah.
Yeah, I did. I watched a cool practice space show you guys did. I watched the drive-in show. You guys have gotten out there, but still not in the same way. What do you miss most about playing a real show?
I think like I saw a tweet recently that was like very, very interesting. That was like talking about how like, there's like an imbalance in like the normal dopamine we have as musicians to like not be playing shows. And I feel like I noticed that because I feel like I'm a little more mild mannered and a little more like, I don't know. I feel like a very different level of energy without it. And I feel like the thing I miss the most about it is that like feeling of, I don't know, like loving your job, like that, like accomplishment thing. Where you're like, oh, I'm doing this thing. And it's like exactly what I want to be doing instead of like kind of like sitting, answering emails and stuff.
What were your plans this year? I assume, you know, there was going to be some touring for this record in the works. What did you guys lose to this year?
We were going to, so first off, in late May, we were going to tour till July, cross country, all around. Do like a full on thing, 42 days. Then after that, had a plan to go to Canada at the end of July for like 5 days and do like 4 Canadian shows and then 1 show in Rochester. In the fall, do like a long ass tour to Fest. Nice. So we had a lot of stuff planned that didn't work out, but it gave us a lot of time to like have a tighter live show because we've been like practicing a whole lot and like it's gonna feel a lot better to come back to it because that we've been like, we've been, instead of playing shows as practice, we've been actually having practice. So all of our shit got canceled, but like at the end, we just got to roll with it and it'll be fun.
What are you looking forward to in this next year coming up?
If it gets back on track, we're going to definitely do our 30-day tour we had planned, definite postponement. And we plan to either go to Japan or Europe. We've been cooped up for this long. Like we want to like plan like a real cool trip, like this kind of thing that's like really random and weird. So we definitely are going to do something international at some point in 2021 if things clear up. We've been talking to people in Europe and that might happen. And we also are definitely recording another record, 100% in the works. We have like 8 or 9 songs written and nice. we're gonna going to write 4 to 5 more. And then we also have a split we're doing. So it's a whole lot of shit. It's going to be fun. The split will be cool. And it's just going up from here. We're just hoping that the world lets us.
Everything's coming up Millhouse, right?
Yeah, literally. Yeah. We're just hoping that the world is just like, oh, fucking, you can have your chance.
Yeah. So I'm going to assume that a lot of people watching, listening have not yet figured out who the band is, what you guys are about. Do you have an elevator pitch, something like families, like, tell me about your band there, Luke?
I'll say something like power pop band. That's like a little more extravagant because of horns and keys. The goal is to push a social justice agenda. That's how I'd explain it to family.
Yeah. How old are you, if you don't mind me asking?
22.
22. You started this band when you were what, 15, 16?
16.
16, man. When I was 16, we were writing songs, you know, very much in the style of Blink 182 songs in gutter mouth, you know, just really dumb punk rock stuff. Well, where do these ideas come from for social justice reform and mental health issues that you're exploring?
I would say that I'm incredibly mentally unhealthy, but that's its own fucking, yeah. That's its own world. But with social justice, I feel like I grew up in a very like not accepting area for like young queer people. And I had to hide that a whole lot. So like, I just like had a lot of like intense thoughts about that I like wanted to document in song. But and at first when I was like younger, I kind of like used metaphors and stuff to talk about it because I wasn't exactly out already. Yeah, no, I feel like I listened to a lot of music that was kind of forward. So I feel like that kind of mended me when I was young to think a certain way and then like actually like read more about stuff. Try my personal best to be the best person I can be. And that's based on the perspective.
Yeah. Well, so like I'm a 40-year-old white cis male. My old roommate, who's like a 42-year-old computer programmer, he texted me not long after the record came out and said, have you heard of this band? You would like it. So there's something that like, even though we're not necessarily this target demographic that like I'm latching
onto. Yeah.
What do you have any idea? I mean, obviously you haven't gotten out there and talked to people, but do you have any idea why this connects so much with so many people that it's connecting with?
Cause we're all fucked up. Like I sing a lot about like gender identity stuff and stuff. Like my goal with our music is to relate to anyone that feels like shit. Like that's like just how I'm programmed to write songs. I feel like I'm just an upset person that hopes that other people feel me.
Well, and that's what's so weird is because I've sat here and I've watched all these videos with you playing, singing, talking about how is Luke always so like upbeat?
I'm able to just like mask stuff. But yeah, the music I write is about like dealing with things and trying to find a different perspective that's not your assigned one. Like I feel like I'm immediately like a fuck this person. And I feel like an important thing for me is to, even if I'm faking it, try and play a better role socially because I don't want to influence anyone else to feel bad, you know?
Do you find that when you're writing songs, when you're letting this stuff out, do you find that that helps you find that inner peace?
I think so, yeah. I definitely feel like it comes to me when I'm playing.
Do you have those moments where you've figured things out about yourself through these writings and songs?
Yeah. I mean, I actually like really have been interested in like listening to a lot of music that makes me happy as my own sort of therapy. And also I've been taking antidepressants now for about a year and that's been super, super good for me. And I wrote a lot of this stuff before I was, and now like this next record, it's the same feeling, but I'm able to look at it in a more like confident way. So I'm hoping that it transcends onto that stuff.
Nice. How are you tapping into these dark places without going to those spots?
I actually, weird enough, was in a little bit more of a lucky position in terms of my own control right before the quarantine started because I was about 6 months sober. And then it started, I started drinking again, but I yeah, but I was able to understand control a lot more, which is like I'm still a person with substance problems, but I realized that my, like, being able to be sober for 6 months created a level of routine and control for me. Nice. So like the quarantine actually wasn't as bad as it could have been if I didn't do some self-help beforehand.
Yeah. I've definitely been on that train. I drink right now, but I have taken those months off, and you learn to not lean on it as a crutch so much. Yeah. And to just let it flow.
I've had two elongated periods of it, and it ends up not working out, but that's one of those things that, like, I don't know, you shouldn't have to be off of something forever if you don't want to. It's good to have those moments of break and stuff just so you can, like, figure yourself out.
Yeah, and really relearn who you are with and without it.
Exactly. You can, like, also, like, use some of the stuff you learned into when you are using again, and then it helps you control yourself a little more.
Yeah. I like that you're just so upfront and honest about all this stuff.
Yeah, like, who cares? I don't owe anyone shit. I'm just...
And so that's what I was actually trying to get at with the thing with me being a 40-year-old male, is the thing I think I identify most with this record and with the stuff you're putting out, is it's the honesty. There's no bullshit on this record. I don't know how to quite put it.
It's just not, it's not really sugar-coated.
Yeah.
I feel like, because it's like, I feel like the only way to make, like, genuine art for me personally is to be honest about what the fuck's going on here. Because I just think that's like, I feel like that's literally the only way for me to, like, actually be expressive, is if I'm, like, just, like, fully there, you know? Like, I feel like me and Eli and Hakeem and everyone have been talking about how, like, an important thing that we have is the fact that we can take this from a very honest perspective, because it helps with the energy, definitely.
Yeah. How scary is it putting that honesty out there in the world?
It was a lot more when I was a little younger, but I've grown into the setting in my mind of just, like, people are gonna think what they want of this shit. Better to just do it at my age than, like, not.
Yeah.
Very hard for me in the past. Recently, I'm coming to terms in a lot easier of a way with the art I'm putting out there, because I've been able to assess it more, been able to, like, think about it more. It's quarantine's actually helped with that, because, like, it's a good feeling of I'm able to pay a lot of attention to what I'm going to do next, instead of, like, have the world go crazy around you.
What is in the water that makes so many great bands come out of Jersey?
I think it's pain. Because this is, like, I love New Jersey, but, like, the general consensus of New Jersey is that it's not great. And I feel like we've all learned to manifest in the not greatness and find very nice parts of it. A lot of the bands from Jersey sing about the same problems, and that feels very fun. And I have, like, friends and bands, and we, like, laugh about that, how it's like, oh, like, we're definitely all singing about Jersey problems.
Well, who are the bands you looked up to growing up in Jersey that you were looking at, who you were looking to advice from?
I really like the Waffle Stompers, and my friends in Have a Good Season were, like, they're only, like, 2 years older than me, playing, like, a year or two before I was playing. Senses Fail was a cool band,
yeah,
from New Jersey that people would go see and stuff. Screaming Females, like, all those bands, they were kind of, like, the first ones for me, like, the Ergs, all that stuff. It was kind of, like, that's, like, my gateway into, like, DIY here. Nice. Those bands. Like Hunchback, all that shit.
Oh, you started this project when you were still in high school, sophomore in high school. But do you have a story about how you learned to write songs and make music?
People said my shit was ass in the beginning. I had to face it. And then that's like, I read a lot of cool stuff, and I was, like, watching a lot of movies and, like, trying to, like, understand poetry more and stuff. And I feel like that kind of got me better at writing songs. Just, like, having test runs of things, showing your friends, being like, what do you think of this? And then what could I do differently? And then just keeping doing that trial and error thing.
I have this idea that somewhere, and because this is going to be on YouTube, anybody can type in Teenage Halloween and hopefully this pops up. And I have this idea that some 16-year-old kid in Iowa is going to be watching this. He's going to hear, or she or they are going to hear this.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
hopefully. Yeah. I want, I'm all about like the youth making music and keeping the dream alive, because that shit won't be as easy one day.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. I hope everyone is, I hope everyone that's younger wants to do this, because someone needs to carry on the torch.
Yeah. What was some of the best advice that you got coming up?
I think I always jokingly tell him when I see him, but I played with this band called Endless Mike and the Beagle Club, and they're friends of mine. And it was one of my first bigger shows. And they said to me, Michael was saying to me something about like, just don't like lose sight of the fact that you started somewhere. Like, never be like too cool for people and stay punk. Like, play fun shows that seem like there's heart in them and stuff.
Yeah.
And I feel like that transcended with me. Like, I really never want to be like this overly choosy person. Like, I really like enjoying music in like a connection way too. So
how does it feel to still be Teenage Halloween, still doing this thing all these 5 years later?
It's a little confusing. I enjoy it. I think it's great. I think that I definitely am in a place where I'm content, and it has been different in the past. And I think that the fact that I've embraced that I've done the same project for a while, and it's like my big thing that I'm keeping going with my friends, is an important thing to grasp. Just be like, oh, this is working out. This is what me and my closest friends write. Keep doing it. Yeah.
So a couple of questions to end it then. Your bandmates aren't here today.
We all have an equal say and part of the creative process. It's not just my band. We are very, very, very fluid with the six people in this band, and I have decided to represent us tonight.
Oh, congratulations on being in a six-person band that is somehow not a ska band as well.
Not a ska band, and we all love to embrace the fact that we aren't. We love ska, but there's too many people in those bands.
Well, can you do me a favor, since they're not here today? Can you just tell us some nice things about your other band members?
Nice things about my other band members. Eli is our lead guitar player, helps me write and compose the songs. Very to the point person, blunt, nice though, very nice. Then Jane, she plays keyboard for us, and she shreds, brings a jazzy classical tinge to our music by adding like shredder ass key parts. Peter is a drummer that is absolutely buck wild, and it sounds like, and it feels like we're playing like the most extravagant music when we're playing four chords. Our bassist Trisha, who also sings, helps write the songs too. She did great on the record and keeps shredding. Hakim plays sax for us, gets better and better every day, and is fucking killer. And has cool solo music coming out soon that's like more electronic. And I'm excited for that, because I don't know a lot of electronic musicians. So that's like pretty cool.
I do love the vocals that you and Trisha have, like the way it's layered. Who recorded the record?
Oh, my good friend, Evan Bernard. He has a studio called Big Mama's. He's done stuff with Obsessives. He's done stuff with Mannequin Pussy, Joyce Manor, all those cool bands. And like, he's helped us out a lot. He played guitar on a couple songs on the record, played tambourine on the record, did a bunch of fun stuff and helped us make this thing happen. And we're doing all of our next stuff with him too.
It sounds great. I love it.
Oh, he's the best. It's going to sound the same consistent way in terms of production, because we're always going to keep working with him.
I love the cover art as well. That's probably what grabbed me and brought me in. Nice. Whose idea was this?
Jordan from Roswell Kid made it, and Jordan was very excited about this idea. Like, Jordan listened to our songs and came up with it, and I'm like, that's awesome. Like, I'm going to make it like, I'm going to somehow intertwine this picture into the concept of the lyrics.
What a great icon right here on the cover.
Yeah. Like, we were worried that it was a little violent at first, but then we looked at it and we realized that it's just more passionate.
Well, after this year, who doesn't want to set it all on fire? Am I right?
Exactly.
I'm curious what, you know, you're putting all this wonderful music out there into the world, but do you have any ideas on, do you ever think about how do I make the world a better place? Do you have any other ideas on how we collectively can do that?
I mean, yeah, collectively. I feel like the concept of self is, it's very, very important in terms of this ideal, like this idealistic like way of thinking. I just feel like the most important thing ever is the fact that we can all collaborate to make the world a better place in our own little ways, if that makes sense. Like, I just feel like community is more important than self, like at the moment, because of the world is fucked. Like people that don't look like me are getting fucked up right now by like the law, by society. I want to listen to those people. Like, I hope that's like, in my opinion, the most important thing. And I'm hoping that I'm making the world a better place by listening, because I think you have to listen right now.
Luke, I think that's a pretty good stopping point. Is there anything we missed that you want to talk about, or anything else you want to throw in there before we let you go?
No, nothing really. This is good.
Yeah, this is great.
Thank you so much.
Will you come back on someday in the future and we can
talk? Hell yeah, whatever you need. I'm down to come on and chill. I'm down to like listen to a record and bullshit. Like, nice. Hit me up.